Hi. How's everyone today? Good? I hope so.
Yo, check this out. My name is Jarrell, and I come from another world. And this world is not Jarrell. And that's why my name is Jarrell.
Damn!
You looking mad cute. Come here, sit right next to me so I can whisper some things in your ear. All right, that's enough of that. All right, so, Moon Song. The Moon Song provided by KSJORIS01. Kiss Jarris. All right, here we go. I love this. My man, I like what you did with this. Okay, here we go. The belief that Satan and Lucifer are one and the same thing, what they call the devil, has remained up to this day. In the New Testament, it is already established that Lucifer and Satan are the same. Luke 10, verse 18, 2 Corinthians 11, 14. Even in Monsignor Murin's work, a certain Monsignor Murin, we find the same confusion. He calls the demiurge Jehovah Lucifer and not Jehovah Satan, which for him would have been correct. And if Murin, a very well-known theologian in the Roman Catholic world, made this mistake, what can we expect from the average man? What can be done to distort the Gnostic idea that this created world is hell and that heaven, the true heaven, not the material one, is the plane of the unknowable God? The conspirators have conceived of the following idea. They state that this world is not hell, that hell is outside, far from here. Hell would be a place of punishment for those who disobey the demiurge during their lives here on earth. And what characteristics would this hell have? It occurred to someone that the typical characteristics of the unknowable world could serve very well as a setting for this new hell. If Lucifer, bearer of light, a being of fire, who is represented ablaze with fire, is Satan, we could then say that this hell would be a place full of flames, a place where sinners are burnt. As far as Gnostics are concerned, the unknowable kingdom is precisely an antimatter fire which loathes this impure creation, and if possible, would annihilate it. For Gnostics, however, that same fire is something good and desirable, and not something satanic. Reading from Jose M. Eru Aragon's work, The Forbidden Religion. The sixth point is that the spirit was another of the things they considered it important to eliminate, or at least render unrecognizable. The representatives of the demiurges on earth could not allow that. After all the doctoring, the belief that there is something uncreated and divine inside of man still persisted. The spirit had to be eliminated as well. We have already seen that for Gnostics, man is composed of three parts: body, soul, and spirit. The body and soul, which in Sanskrit is known as the jiva, were created by the demiurge, whereas the spirit, with a capital S, has been captured in the plane of the uncreated and eternal and does not belong to the sphere of creation. The soul and the spirit, the two entities invisible to the average human eye, are the complete opposite and are irreconcilable. The soul, jiva, was created by the demiurge. It is that which gives life to the body. The animic aspect. Only the soul longs to be united with its creator, to be merged with him. The spirit, on the other hand, is a prisoner in this strange world in which it doesn't belong, and for it is hell. It only wants to liberate itself and return to the unknowable world from which it came. For the spirit, the body, and the soul are as dreadful as matter and time. For the demiurge and his creation, whether we call him Brahma, whether we call him Jehovah, yes, whether we call him Olofi, it is necessary, fundamental even, that the spirit remains tied to the soul of man. His evolutionary plan cannot do without the spirits that are enchained to matter. However, one thing is important. The demiurge wants this to remain a secret. For man never to realize that inside of him is an uncreated spark stolen from another world. So, in order to eliminate Gnostic thought about the spirit, the agents of the demiurge on Earth came up with this ingenious idea. From the two entities, opposed and irreconcilable, they would make only one. They would take all the divine characteristics of perfection and purity from the spirit. They would only leave out its uncreated aspect. Since if man discovered he had something uncreated inside of him, he would begin to ask questions. And that is no good for man to ask questions about his true eternal self. All the virtues of the spirit would be transferred to the soul, which in this way would turn it from a satanic entity into a perfect one. Now there would be no more talk of the uncreated spirit. Not only one entity within the human body would remain, the divine and perfect soul created by God. We have said that at the beginning of Christianity, the first Christian theologians, Saint Augustine amongst others, always referred to the body, soul, and spirit of man. But as the years passed, this began to disappear. The spirit was being transformed, firstly in intellect, then as one with the soul, until one fine day it was decided to remove it completely as a constituent part of the human being, leaving behind only body and soul. The conspiracy was a success. Man forgot about the spirit. Yes. But the spirit is eternal. The spirit is beyond all concepts, limiting concepts of space and time.